So just by way of summarizing what we are, so the database, we're a database company, a NoSQL database company, and the code base is very mature. It's been around for about over 30 years, and it's running some extremely large, running the largest real-time core banking applications that I know of anywhere, as well as a nation-scale electronic health record system. So it's a mature code base. And the cool thing is that it not only scales up to these very large systems, it also scales down all the way to run on a Raspberry Pi Zero. And if you come down to our table, you can actually see it running on an x86 and then a Pi 3, 32-bit and 64-bit, and a Pi Zero as well. And of course, each of them has different throughput capabilities, but the same software will run on the same databases, and you can take a database from one and put it on the other. So, and because of our background in banking and finance, in the code base, and because of the maturity of the code base, it's our tagline is basically rock solid, lightning fast, secure, pick any three. So I'll talk a little bit about where we are and how we got here. Talk a little bit about taking the mature technology and making it into something new. And also, our roadmap for the future. Then we'll get to the demo, and demos are never done. Demos are always a work in progress. So, you take the demo, then you sort of do something else with it and do something else with it. Okay, so how did we get here? Interestingly, the first database ever made was a NoSQL database. And it predated SQL by about 5 years. So this is actually built for, to this day, the Saturn V rocket that put people on the moon was actually the most powerful rocket ever built. And only when SpaceX fires up they have the Falcon 9 Heavy, for the first time there'll be a rocket more powerful than the Saturn V. But the Saturn V was a marvel of engineering at the time. Because of the complexity and the technology, remember the moonshot was managed by IBM 1794 and 1798 computers, which are basically about as powerful as those TI calculators that kids take to school. That's about how powerful it was. Of course, it had a lot more tape drives and disk storage and whatnot, but computationally, that's what it was. And the bill of materials they needed to manage the Saturn V project was extremely complex. So they created, IBM created this database. Actually, it was IBM, Rockwell, and someone else. So they created this database called IMS. And IMS is actually still in existence today. Still, they have releases. So IBM actually, the latest release was in 2017. And so it's been continuously developed. And so, old software lives forever. It's kind of like cities. I mean, you don't just go around and say, if Julius Caesar was around and probably saw London, Paris, and Rome, but if he were to show up today, he would not recognize London, Paris, or Rome. But they've been cities for 2,000 years, and they've been around, and I think that increasingly we sort of look at software in those terms. Sorry. Now, the thing about this particular software is that it runs in a mainframe. Mainframes are expensive. The software is expensive. So anyone recognize that? So this is a picture from about 1840 of Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston. And it was something like the third or fourth hospital in the US. And that was a time when hospitals were for treating the public. Rich people got treated in their homes. So doctors would come to their homes, but hospitals were for the hoi polloi. And so this was one of the first hospitals built to treat people in the US. And even today, it's one of consistently looking at the ratings, it's one of the top hospitals in the country, and it's a major research institution. So Massachusetts General Hospital, and So they had an animal research laboratory, and they had limited funding for computing. You know, they had grants and whatnot for doing their animal research, but they didn't have money for computing. But they happened to have a spare DEC PDP-7 lying around. And by the way, a DEC PDP-7 is also the machine on which Unix first ran. And it was written in a language that was the predecessor of C, a language called B. And so they had a spare computer, they had talent, so literally Mass General Hospital is across the river from Cambridge, where MIT is there. And there's also a company called Bolt, Peranek and Newman that is still in existence, but in those days was considered one of the, you know, the premier research institutions in the country. And today, you know, you have people like the Rand Corporation and SRI, Stanford Research International, and people like that. So they basically, like, they do funded research, and so they were there. So they put together this system called MUMPS. And MUMPS is an acronym for Massachusetts General Hospital Utility Multi-Programming System. And if you can say that in one breath, you know, you're better than I am. And, you know, it was the healthcare world, it was an inside joke. And it was first created around the same time. The interesting thing about that was that it allowed that mini computer, the DEC PDP-7, to solve very similar types of applications to IMS on the IBM mainframe. And the reason it was able to do that was because MUMPS was everything. Literally, you booted the computer to go into MUMPS. It was the operating system, the file system, the user interface, the programming language. You know, kind of like when you turn on your calculator, there is no, you know, it's all in one. And so that actually allowed it to work. And the other thing was that the ecosystem was actually, so, you know, the traditional software ecosystem is you have the users, and then there's someone who sits down, writes down all the specs, and then you have the programmers, they write the, you know, they write the code, then it goes back, it gets tested, and so on. So back in the 1960s, they actually had, in this environment, programmers sitting side by side with the users, and the users would kind of say, this is kind of what I want, the programmers would, you know, program it that day or the next day, whatever. Then they'd go back, they'd critique it. So literally it was a form of extreme programming or you know, fast turnaround, short development cycles. But one of the things that it did was it developed, it led to a culture of short development cycles and software that is very pragmatic and driven to user needs rather than software that had any sort of, you know, abstraction or mathematical models or anything like that. And again, this was in the late 1960s and early 1970s. And so what's the structure of the data? So the structure of the data is basically just tuples. And the key value tuples, and essentially you can have any number of keys, and then there is a value at that key. And so this is always sorted. Okay, so there's a saying in MUMPS. MUMPS means never having to say you're sorting, because it's stored in a key value tuple that's stored in a tree structure. It's always there and it's sorted. And this actually turned out to be a very efficient way to store and retrieve data. By the way, if you program in PHP, you'll see a lot of similarities between this and PHP, as well as awk and several other things. So it's a, you know, common construct. And the language and the database make no, there's no interpretation to what you store. That interpretation is entirely up to the application code. So you can literally have, you know, one key, I mean, a set of keys, and you're storing geographic information, you're storing population information, you could be storing financial information. And one of the other things about MUMPS is that numbers and strings, a string, by the way, is just a sequence of bytes. There's no, you know, it's not that you're restricted to the ASCII code or anything like that. And you can freely intermix those. There's a certain category of strings that are called canonical numbers, and they're treated specially, and they sort before the general strings. But basically, this is a little bit like, you know, playing poker in a boat in the rain, and all wet cards are wild, so anything goes. So again, the application would then say, okay, if the first key happens to is called population, is a string population, then it's population data. If it's, you know, capitals, then it's capital data. And the other interesting thing is that you could freely mix key sizes. So there's no restriction imposed by the language of the database and what the, you know, the key size. So for example, you could have something like this where you're storing current population as well as historical population. And here in this case, I'm just saying that the, you know, to get a good sorting order, that the data is stored in the, you know, as year, month, day. And then the application can be written to say if the first key is population, and then there's one more key, then that's the current population. If it's population and two more keys, then it's a historical population. So again, it's entirely up to the application to decide what the data means. The database doesn't decide. And as you can see, you know, this is basically just a tree structure. So you could have, you know, population, and then that same population as a tree. Now, one of the differences here, I mean, this is kind of like JSON, except in JSON you can't have a value at the root of a tree and in the subtrees, whereas here you can have a value at the root and you can have values in the subtrees. So any JSON structure can be stored in a MUMPS or an M database, and then, you know, the converse is not true, but you can always put data in and get it out, but you can create data that's hard to export in JSON format. The other interesting thing is that, you know, we talk about key value tuples, but what's a natural structure to programmers? Arrays, right? I mean, we're all used to programming in arrays. So in the language and in the database, the idea was that the first key would be called a variable name, other keys would be called subscripts, and the value would be the value. So it kind of looks like a sparse array. So this is something that is extremely familiar to a programmer and easy to use. And another interesting insight was that, you know, spot the difference. If the variable starts with a caret, that means that it's persistent and it's shared, that goes into the database. If it doesn't have a caret, it's within the process, it's local to the process, but it's not shared across processes. And when the process goes away, that data is gone. But essentially, this makes it very easy, you know, so you don't have to think about persistence. When you want something to persist, you just put the caret in front of it, right? It's not as if you've got to convert from a, you know, you get a row and you have to unpack the row and then do something with the row and then repack it. It's all the same structure, whether it's you're manipulating it in the process or whether you're persisting it. And it turns out that this hierarchical key value data model map is a superset of all of the common NoSQL. Sorry, you should just turn off my notifications when someone sends mail, but that's okay. So someone about 10 years ago noticed that and actually wrote a white paper saying, hey, this structure maps to all of the common, you know, the column-oriented databases, the JSON, the network databases, and so on. And also, NoSQL means not only SQL in the sense that we can now do both SQL and NoSQL. Okay, so what are some of the key features of this technology? So one is the tight binding of the database to the language. So if you want something to live in the database, it's just an array reference. You want to read something from the database, it's an array reference. And then in the initial implementation, that something that made it possible to run on a DEC PDP 7 was that it was direct execution of the source code. All right, welcome. So it was direct execution of the source code. And so literally there was an interpreter that read the source code memory and executed it, you know, line by line, character by character. A couple of other features which we pioneered that only later became common in programming languages. One is dynamic linking. So literally you could create a function called a routine call. And that routine didn't need to exist when you wrote the program, it needed to exist when you ran the program. And furthermore, one of the other kinds of dynamism is that you could actually modify a routine and then have the new version of the routine linked and run. So that is something that you know, to this day, most languages don't have. But here you can actually do that, and you can. And one of the other features of the language is that the program can be introspective. A program can actually read its own source code. And by doing that, so for example, if you want to initialize something, the culture is you put comments in the code and you read the comments in the code and then you do the initialization. So again, that was a feature of the language. And then multitasking was, again, part of the language right from the very beginning. So it always thought in terms of concurrent activity. And then there was there's an interactive and an incremental use. So, you know, like with the shell, you can type something and then have it executed. You can create a shell script. That philosophy was there in the language from the beginning. And one of the unique features of the language also, and of this is also there in the database, is, as you'll see, I talk as if it's a language and the database all the same. Once upon a time it was, but you'll see as I get further down into the talk that we kind of separated that. But these were key features that allowed it to run on a PDP 7. And the hierarchical locks are kind of like what I call traffic light semantics. So what that means is, if you think about a lock on a door, unless you have the key, you can't walk through the door. Or unless you flash Gordon and you can vibrate. So you can't walk through the door if it's locked. On the other hand, with a traffic light, if you see a red light, nothing physically stops you from going through the light. It's a convention that you stop. And so there are locks in the language and the database, but that lock is a convention. It's not something that prevents you from doing something. And the other key thing is that it's hierarchical. So just as you have the resource name of a lock, it's just like a variable name. So there's a variable and you have subscripts. And let's say if I take a lock on X and my subscript is my PID, someone else can take a lock on X with that process's PID, but another process can't come along and take a lock on X without the PID. Okay, but similarly, if someone has a lock on X without the PID, I can't come in and take a lock that says X with the PID. So there's a hierarchical locking, so you can actually lock out an entire tree. And that turns out to be extremely useful. And by the way, this was, 1970 plus or minus a few years happened to be a particularly productive time in computing. So contemporaries of MUMPS, and I say MUMPS, and then it actually got standardized by ANSI and ISO as M. Because, MUMPS is kind of a nice name as an inside joke in healthcare. But if you can imagine the CIO of a bank going to the board of directors saying, we've chosen our future technology and it's called MUMPS. It's kind of like making a presentation with ketchup stains on your tie. And you can get past it, but why? So, but these are all things that came about at the same time. C, Unix, TCP, IP, SQL. SQL actually came a few years later, but it was roughly in that time frame. So how did things evolve? So in the 1970s, so right at the very beginning, it was an operating system, a programming environment and everything, but the operating system became a separate entity. And then the language and the database became a separate entity. And then the in the 1980s, there was an implementation of MUMPS called GTM. It's still there. And what that did is it basically separated. So the programs used to be stored in the database. That was, again, one of the things that allowed it to work. So it said programs don't belong in the database. Programs are actually separate things. So you have text files, which are compiled, and then you have the database. And at the same time, the interesting thing was it did incremental compilation, so it actually allowed the, you know, the users to have that same, you type a line and execute it, but you can also write a program in a text file. Again, kind of like shell scripts, except shells are interpreted, whereas this is actually compiled. It would incrementally compile as you wrote it. And then in GTM, because of the, it was used extensively in banking and finance, it got asset transactions, and I'll talk about those in a minute. And then for a variety of reasons, there was vendor consolidation, and at one point there were just two vendors left. And that happened because if you remember in the early 1990s, the computer industry was going through, went through a big crash on digital equipment, which used to have about, I don't know, 300,000 people. And I remember in Boston going on Route 128, they had digital trucks and, you know, they had a digital helicopter service flying from Logan Airport to Marlborough. I mean, it was the thing. And then they suddenly crashed. IBM also went through a crash right around that time. And a whole bunch of mini computer vendors disappeared. Well, one of the things that happened was Digital had was actually the biggest developer of MUMPS at the time, and they literally sold their implementation to an entrepreneur for virtually nothing. I think it was like $1 or some amount like that. So he took that and he bought up all the other MUMPS implementations except GTM, which I happened to manage. I managed GTM from 1995 to 2017. And so there were just two commercial implementations left. And then in the early 2000s, we moved GTM on Linux to a free and open source license. So initially GPL v2, and then when GPL v3 came out, GPL v3, and then eventually to AGPL v3. And then in 2017, some of us left the Fortune 500 company where that developed GTM, and we formed YottaDB to take the code base to, you know, to evolve it beyond just the narrow interest of the parent company. Okay, so let's talk about asset transactions. That's one of those things which is a key feature of some databases. So let's take the example of, you know, you move $100 from your checking account, from a savings account to your checking account. So what's the logic? You get the balance on the checking account. You make sure that there's enough balance to move the funds. You subtract the balance from the checking account. You add that to the balance in the savings account. You have to log the transaction, right? Because all banking transactions need to be recorded in a log file. And then if the stars are all aligned, you know, at this point, you can commit, right? But think about all the things that it requires. So acidity means it all happens and none of it happens, because if you, let's say that you subtracted the amount from your savings, and then the system crashed and it didn't get deposited to your checking, you'd be upset. Similarly, if the system crashed, let's say before it got logged, then the regulators would be upset, and then the bank executives would be in trouble. Now, it's okay to say none of it happened. I mean, you might be unhappy that your transfer didn't go through, but at least you're financially whole, everyone's happy. So atomic is either it all happens or none of it happens. Consistency and isolation are kind of dualities of each other. So consistency means the bank must always be in balance, right? Their assets and liabilities must always balance out. And if someone were to look at the bank, then that they can't see the state inside a transaction, right? So when you're actually executing the logic of the transaction, that's an inconsistent state because, you know, you've subtracted the amount from savings, you're going to deposit it to checking. That particular state out there is inconsistent from a business logic point of view. If you look at the state of the database, let's say after you've done the financial transfer, but before you've logged it, that again is an inconsistent state. So consistency means that, you know, that if this process goes and looks at other accounts other than the one that it's computing on, they must all appear to be consistent. And the duality of that is isolation, which is that no other process should be able to look inside this process, and this process should be able to execute the transaction as if it's the only one happening on the system. And durability says once you do the commit, then at that point, that transaction is permanent. There's a permanent record of the transaction, right? You can't, there are no backsees. And so this is very important, and it's not just in banking, it's there in, you know, lots of other other cases as well. So, yet again, this is that that same example. So, YottaDB actually excels in transactions. Now, it turns out that atomicity and durability are kind of not that hard to achieve, but consistency and isolation are extremely difficult, especially if you want scalability and performance. Because just think about it, isolation says each transaction should be able to execute as if it's the only one on the system. Well, if you have a bank with millions of users, if you say that it can only execute one transaction at a time, that's not a very scalable solution. And so the other databases typically use a form of record locking to do consistency. We don't. And the real thing about record locking is that it's a form of pessimistic concurrency control, which will essentially guarantee you that there's no conflict as far as your data is concerned. But you have to lock more than you actually need to. So in the case of optimistic concurrency control, it was actually developed in the early 1980s. And this is the seminal paper. Very few databases actually do it. Most of them have gone the pessimistic route. So in optimistic concurrency control, what happens is inside a T-start, transaction start, sorry, let me back up a second. Every database block has got a transaction number associated with it, which is the transaction number at which that block was last updated. Once a process goes inside a transaction start, it keeps a record of every database block that it reads. And by the way, every database block that it wants to update, it has to read first before it can update it. So that suffices for the update side as well. And it keeps a record of the transaction number of that block when it read it. Any updates, it doesn't apply to the database, but it keeps it in process private space. At transaction commit time, it looks at all of the blocks that it has read, and it says, did any of these change since I read it? And if any of them changed, the transaction number would have changed. If none of them has changed, then it can commit the transaction at that point. If even one of them has changed, it basically says, I have to throw away my work and restore the state of the process to the transaction start, and then I can re-execute the transaction. And the, sorry, I jumped ahead of my line. So what it does is, in most cases, that, you know, unless I happen to be at an ATM in Bellingham and my wife happens to be at an ATM in Philadelphia at exactly the same time, the chances of two transactions colliding are low. However, if they do collide, one of them will get restarted. So the way it works is you detect the collision, you restart it, and you do it over. And our strategy is basically you try it once, try it a second time, try it a third time. And after the third time, you say, okay, I'm just going to, at that time, we sort of switch to a locking approach. We lock everything and then execute the entire transaction inside a critical section and no other processes can be updating the.
So going back to your previous discussion on two transactions are going on, or a transaction is going on, and it says it verifies or tries to determine if the data that's being
Well, if the database
has been changed,
any of the bucks, so the database is bucks. So each buck has a transaction number.
Okay.
And it then tries to see did any of those bucks change.
Oh, okay. The blocks. I thought you were talking about the transaction. Okay. Thanks.
And it determines that whether it changed by looking at the transaction number in the buck.
Okay.
So we try it once. We try it twice, we try it three times. If we still fail, then we lock everyone out and then do the transaction in a critical section. So that means that there is a pathological case. So with the locking approach, the pathological potential is that there's a potential for deadlock if you don't do the locking correctly. In our case, there's a potential for a sort of a one through the gate system where if all transactions are essentially, let's say every transaction happens to hit the same block, then what that's going to do is cause a hot point of the block. Every transaction is going to collide, restart, go through three times, and the fourth time it's going to go through. So it's essentially going to sort of create a pathological case where you now have slower throughput. Kind of like the way that, you know, if you have a door and if people are lining up, you can actually get a lot of people through that door smoothly. But if everyone's jamming up against the door, then getting through that door becomes harder. You actually get fewer people through the door than if you line up. So that's exactly that same thing that happens with the database. And typically we've got tools to analyze this. So if you happen to see that a transaction is getting a lot of restarts, then the application needs to find a way to work around that by avoiding the pathological case. So where we are today, if you look at the code base, especially with the in the GTM brand name, is currently running three or four of the largest real-time banking systems in existence in the world. And these are systems with, you know, 30, 40 million accounts. Now if you look, and these are all international, by the way, if you look in the US, there are certainly banks like, you know, the Citi and Wells Fargo and others that have huge numbers of customers, but they don't run them on one system. These banks all came by acquiring other banks and they run their different systems. So you have literally islands of systems. Whereas overseas, some of the banks actually run all of their customers on one system. And so it's currently running there. And it's also running a nation-scale electronic health record system. And this is in the country of Jordan. So they actually are rolling out electronic health records for the entire country. And Jordan is, let's say, roughly the size and population of Indiana. So they have a military health system, and then they have the Ministry of Health system, and the Ministry of Health has got, you know, nation-scale electronic health record system, and then there's a military one, which is similar. But it's not widely used in general purpose computing. And I'll talk a little bit about some of the reasons, and I'll talk about what we're doing at YottaDB to try and go to the world at large. Okay, so some of the so in some sense we all tend to be victims of our own success, that things that we do well today may be the things that hamper us tomorrow. And that certainly was the case with M. So direct execution of code was one of the things that made it possible for a PDP-7 to do what it did. And what that meant was that you wanted to save memory. Those are small computers. And so in the language, most of the keywords like write can be abbreviated to W. Quit, which is kind of like return, can be abbreviated to Q. So this is actually, you know, perfectly good and legal code. Now that's not the way that we might necessarily write it today, but that's what allowed it to work then. The other one was that because of the fact that they were running enterprise scale applications on these small computer systems, and the fact that you had these single letter abbreviations, it led to very dense code. Now, this is actually extremely well-structured code. I actually took this off a system called Vista, which if anyone gets any health care at the Department of Veterans Affairs in the US, that's the system they use. So this is actually reasonably well-structured code. You know, this is like a substring operation. This is like taking a string, and if the string has got period as a separator, this is a variable name. If the string has that as a separator between the values, take the second piece of that. So again, this is well-structured code, but it's expert-friendly. Right, you take someone who, if you haven't seen this code before, you're going to look at it and say, what is this? So that was one of the reasons why this didn't become more widely accepted, although it is more or less a de facto standard in healthcare. Another one is that successful applications of long lives. So code that was written in the 1970s and 1980s is not written to the same level of maintainability that it is today. And again, this is one of those cases where the analogy with cities is very real. Because when, you know, when they laid out Boston 300 years ago, they weren't thinking about cars. They weren't thinking about, you know, freeways and subways and all of those things. They basically laid out the streets for horse-drawn carriages. The streets work really well for horse-drawn carriages, but there are parts of Boston where, you know, driving a car is challenging. It's the same thing with Philadelphia and New York and so on. And the other thing is that, you know, when you have a very large application, the complexity is not so much in the language, but there's a tremendous amount of complexity in the application itself. Right? You need to know what the layers are of the API, who calls what the standards are for the schema. And so consistency means that sometimes coding style tends to be an older coding style, even if today, you know, languages and coding styles have evolved. So this is a, you know, as a practical matter, is one of the limitations of M. And then on the commercial side, because of the reason I talked about, there was basically one vendor acquired all of the implementations except GTM, which kind of meant that there were those who were locked in, and then there were those who looked at it and said, we don't want to be locked in, so we're not going to go with the technology. And that was one of the things that actually led us to open source GTM, because at that point that kind of takes away some of the sense of being a proprietary technology. And there were some cultural issues. So what happened was that, you know, M evolved in the healthcare community. And today, if someone comes in and says, we want to do standards, it's like, oh yeah, let's do standards, right? Because that's going to expand the usage. But the thinking in the 1970s and 1980s was more, you know what, if we allow other people to use our technology, they're going to want to evolve it, to take it. So we're going to keep this as something that's really good for the healthcare community. And so that was kind of a certain insular thinking. And the other thing was that MUMPS never got any respect from academia, because it is always a very pragmatic technology. As I said, it was this thing where users and programmers would often sit side by side, and the users would say, this is kind of what I want. The programmer would code it up, and the next day the user would look at it. And so, you know, if you look at relational technology, you can actually write mathematical equations about it. You can prove theorems about it. There are no theorems to be proven here. It's just one of those things that works. And it works because the end user drove the need directly in a very immediate kind of way. And end users are not thinking about, I mean, you may have a doctor who's thinking about some medical model. He's not thinking about a mathematical model for the programming language. He just says, this is kind of what I want to see. So there was never any respect in academia. So as far as I know, there are only about two or three people in academia who ever did anything in MUMPS. Okay, so now there's the old technology, and of course, you know, people tend to think of that as legacy. I think tend to think of that as heritage, because the challenge with, I mean, the things that are old, at least they're proven, you know what they are, you know what the pluses and minuses are. So how do we leverage that, you know, without throwing away what worked and then, you know, starting from scratch? So the diamond here is actually the database. You know, it's a NoSQL database, it's strong, it's robust, it's proven. And getting a database to that level of robustness and performance and security is not easy. I mean, there's a lot that goes on in it. So we want to build on that. And then the language is what it is, okay? And we actually have a blog post on the anchovy pizza company, something like that. So there are people who love it, and I know people who can crank out, you know, in a couple of hours, if you know, they can crank out code that might take someone else writing in another language in a few days to do. But I'm never going to come to you and say my religion is better than yours, and I'm never going to persuade you. And you know, conversely, you also have the flip side, so you're never going to persuade me. And you know, there's the old joke of the guy back in the days of when in Northern Ireland there were the troubles. So this guy is driving along and he's stopped by this group of tough looking people. And they say, yeah, are you a Catholic or a Protestant? And he says, well, actually, I'm an atheist. So they say, that's all very good, but are you a Catholic atheist or a Protestant atheist? And, it's one of those things where we want to build on the database, and then the language, we want to be language agnostic and allow people to use whatever language they want to use. So in terms of building on what works well, you know, you pick what works well and you build on it. Now, these two pictures are both taken from Germany, and they're about 100 years apart. But if you were to walk up to one of those bicycles, would you have any trouble riding it? No, I mean, you can. And similarly, if that guy came out here and saw one of these bicycles, sure, he'd have to get used to gears because it's a single-speed bike. But again, fundamentally, he'd be able to get on this bike and ride it. So things that work well because they've sort of evolved to work well, and so we should build on those. And then, you know, you adapt to what's different. So there are gears, and then I'm sure that his bicycle probably weighed at least 20 pounds more than any of those other bikes because it is probably built with, you know, solid steel tubing, and these were aluminum and things like that. So our approach was to say, what is it that worked well for M? It was the tight binding between the language and the database. So using the database was, you know, it was tightly bound. You could just, you didn't have to connect to the database. You didn't have to, you know, use a data model. It was just there. So we said, we want to make it easy to use, and we chose C as the starting point, because C is the kind of the lingua franca of computing. I probably shouldn't say that in France, because I might get swatted. But anyway, C is the lingua franca of computing. Everyone knows how to communicate or interact or interface with C. So we actually created it to where, you know, you source a file, and that file sets environment variables. And then for the rest of it, you just bounce on include the header file. You compile it, and then you run your program. And that's the model that we created. And the functions are, you know, pretty much the same. So you can set the value at a node. You can get the value at a node, whether it's a local or a global variable. One of the things about sparse arrays is you need to know what the next subscript is and what the previous subscript is, because it's, you know, not like an array, but it's just a sequence of integers. So we have subscript, next, and previous. And then, this is for depth first traversal, this is for breadth first traversal. For transactions, what we did is, we said we're going to create this function, and then you pass it a function. Right, so the function that you pass it has the logic for the transaction. And then this function, YDBTPS, will actually call that multiple times as needed if it's not able to commit. So when that other function returns, that's when YDBTPS tries to do the commit. And again, we have a lot more functions in the API, but these are the core. And so C is, we released that last year, so it's available today. And literally, you could download it today, and you can do the exactly what I told you, the set the environment, pound sign include, and then compile and run.
How many other languages besides C?
Good question. So there's a language called Go, which is developed by Google. It's also called Golang. And so we're doing that. This is actually available today in a field test form. And again, you can see that with Go, we actually created what we call an easy API and a simple API. So the easy being easier than the simple. But anyway, there's a set of functions. So you can actually download this and use it today. And more languages. So there's a language called Rust. And Rust is developed by the Mozilla Foundation. So in some sense, if you think about Go as being the successor to C++, Rust is kind of the successor to C. So Go is more of an application programming focus. Rust is more of a system software development focus. And so we actually have Rust it's not yet even field test grade in the sense that, so you have to go to GitLab to see the documentation, whereas the other one we've actually published. But we actually had a talk yesterday where there was a live demo with Rust, where this is to monitor terminals. And so let's say for security purposes or whatever, you want to capture what's going on in a terminal session for another user. Of course, you have to have the right privileges to do that. But we demonstrated how you can do that with Rust and put that in the database for audit purposes and so on. After we do Rust, the next language will be Python. So it's currently being, we're thinking about it, but we haven't really started the work. As resources become available, we'll do that. And then, because we're 100% open source, we actually have an active user community. So one of our users has created a Node.js API to the database. Another member of our user community has created a Perl. So you can, go to MetaCPAN and get the Perl wrapper for the database. So the idea here is that, one database, you can access it from any language that you want to access. And, kind of like a pizza place, right? They make great pizza. You can go in and you can order whatever kind of pizza you want. And, should you want like chocolate chip and dill pickle pizza, if there's enough of a demand for it, they'll make it for you. We're also working on a SQL engine. And this is in very early alpha test. We're currently working with one user for this. And the approach that we're going to take is, again, we can do anything, we can't do everything, and we can't do it all at once. So we're actually starting out by doing read-only access to the NoSQL data. And then over time, we'll add read-write capability. And eventually, our goal is for this to be, kind of like Postgres or MariaDB or any of those other databases. But you'll be able to do it at a NoSQL, as a NoSQL database and as a SQL database. And we'll be able to offer the extreme level of performance that we're able to offer with the strong ACID transactions. But again, this is kind of where we're heading. I'm trying to give you a snapshot of where we came from, where we are, and where we're going. We've also expanded the platforms that we run on. So initially we started with x86 Linux, but we added Linux on ARM. So if you come down to our table, we actually have a demo of this thing running on a Raspberry Pi 0, a Raspberry Pi 3, and x86 64. And we recently released 64-bit for the ARM V8, like, again, Raspberry Pi 3. So both that and that are Raspberry Pi 3, but on the Pi 3, you can run 32-bit or 64-bit Linux. Okay, so where are we going? So our goal is persistence from any language, whatever you want it. So persistence is the key to what we do. I mean, that's our expertise, that's what we want to do. So we scale up to do these very large databases, and that's not going to go away. We'll scale down to very small databases, and obviously we'll do everything in between. But this is kind of, you know, where we want to go, where we want to stay, which is these cases where, as a database business, we sort of live and die by the integrity of the data that's entrusted to us. And I know there are some applications where the data has to be approximately correct, but it doesn't have to be exactly correct. You know, let's say you're doing a search on your favorite search engine for whatever, you know, books on, you know, 101 ways to cook an octopus. Well, if you and I get different results for that search, it doesn't really matter as long as the searches are approximately the same, right? The popular cookbooks on octopus cookbook should be up on top, but if someone happens to miss, you know, one person gets a search on, you know, Cajun blackened octopus and the other person doesn't, well, that's not that big of a deal. Whereas in things like banking and health records and a lot of other applications, it has to be right. And we're also staying compatible with the upstream. So the upstream GTM, which is maintained by this Fortune 500 company where we used to work. So they stayed with the MUMPS language. They didn't expand to other languages. And their focus is just, they're the largest provider of software and services to banks. So that's their business. But that software is open source, and as they create releases of that, we'll just take those releases and merge them into our code base. And at the same time, we'll evolve the code base with our own enhancements and fixes. And we're able to do that because the three of us worked together in the GTM group for over 20 years. So I joined in 1995. I think he came in 1996 and 1997. So we worked together for over 20 years, and then in 2017 we left to start YottaDB. Okay, now, we'll get to the demo, and you've got to understand that, I give demos the way that I play pool, which is when I call my shots, I say, watch this. And so we'll see what we have. So what I have here is a Raspberry Pi Zero with a display attached to it, and it runs Raspbian Linux. I'm going to plug that in and boot it up. Okay, so it's booting. So we let that boot up. It takes a bit. And then what I have here is an EEG sensor. That's a $100 thing. It's a consumer grade sensor. This is not something that, you know, if you wanted to go in for a brain scan, this is not what they'd use. But it was actually developed for gaming. And again, there's a newer model of this that's out. By the way, this is, having this clip on my ear is the most uncomfortable thing I can think of. And I can't imagine how people go around with things clipped to their ears and then hanging out. But anyway, so that's the demo. So what you're going to see, hopefully, so I'm basically going to demonstrate YottaDB kind of working as a single database that works on the edge and in the cloud. So it's a good fit for Internet of Things applications, and typically there's an IoT stack. So this is kind of what I'm wearing, which is going to hopefully pick up my brainwaves, and hopefully I'll be thinking something profound. And then what I'm going to use for demonstrating this in real time is something called Chernoff's faces. So Chernoff was a statistician. Actually, I don't know if he, I should say is or was, but back in the 1970s, they had a problem with a currency forger in Switzerland. And the problem was that these forgeries were so good that they were actually, you know, bank employees had trouble spotting the forgeries and distinguishing them first. So people were passing these forgeries off. So they called in Chernoff to kind of do an analysis. And what he found was that the forgers' banknotes were actually better than the Swiss banknotes. So the Swiss banknotes had defects on them. The forgeries were perfect. And he came up with a way to depict high dimensionality data. So what are we good at? You know, we're good at recognizing faces, right? You know, if a rabbit were to come in and look at us, it would not recognize different faces. It would say, you know, there's a bunch of six humans in the room. But we're good at recognizing faces. So what Chernoff did was he took different parameters of the banknotes, and he came up with these cartoon faces, and he said each of these parameters now, you know, I'm going to apply that to different parameters of the face, right? The angle of the eyebrow, the shape of the mouth, and so on. So you can actually, with a single image, show something like up to 20 different parameters. And I think he used 10. And so what I have here is a Chernoff's face of the EEG data that's going in. And since it's probably a little hard to see, that's actually a video that I took last year. And again, I don't know what the different parameters mean. They're just, you know, mapped to a Chernoff's face. I'm sorry for the jumpy video. I don't know why it's doing that. So from a block diagram point of view, what we have is the EEG sensor that's communicating over Bluetooth to, and you haven't seen all of it yet, but it's communicating by Bluetooth to a Raspberry Pi Zero. And that kind of simulates the edge. And then one of the ways by which we get business continuity is we have real-time database replication in the database engine itself. So we're doing replication from one database to another database. So this is a simulated cloud. And then from the cloud, we're going to display the data. And then, in theory, you could also take that data. If this were a real thing, you could feed it into an electronic health record system or whatever. So in order to do that, I have to So this one is actually a Raspberry Pi Zero W, so it has a Wi-Fi as well, and it's functioning as an access point. Let me start up a browser. So let's try So essentially, this is data that's coming off the simulated cloud. And in case you're wondering, what is he thinking? Well, now you know. And again, because this is Pi0, it's running as an access point and a web server and everything. It's not quite as speedy as it could be. But anyway, so you can see that it's actually recording and showing the data. And this is actually coming off a database of historical data, so you can go back and look at the data. So that's kind of a demo of the application and the database running, you know, all the way from the edge to the cloud. And by the way, the demo is entirely, you know, we're 100% free and open source company, so everything that we do is out in the open. And so what we have is the database. There's a C API, and the demo is actually written in node.js. So we're using the node.js wrapper developed by someone in our community. And then there's the display is actually something called Qt.js, which is again something which is developed in the community that's there. And then the browser, and then we're using an open source D3 framework to actually display the data. So the whole thing is out there. You know, if you feel like, you know, recording your brain waves, you can do it. And so those are all the links. So all of the YottaDB code is out here. So if you start there, you'll find sub-projects where it is. The website has got links to the documentation. These are the node.js and the Perl APIs that are written by the community. And that's my email address. I have business cards if you have any questions, or if you want to do any follow-up. And that's about the end of it. And I'm going to take this off because I can't stand this any longer.